사이랑 Let me wish you all a Merry Christmas. Next week is Christmas celebration. For information, we have celebration from 20th of this month that will go on till 27th. We have got so many programs, choir by students, choir by international group, choir by children, and talks by eminent speakers. That the program details relating to Christmas celebration. Well, I'm sure that you'll have an enjoyable time. Christmas meant a lot to every one of us, particularly Sai devotees. Christmas is not merely a celebration of Christians. Certainly not. Sai devotees who heard Baba's talks earlier on occasions like this will certainly agree with me that Christmas has got a message to each and every one of us. We had some discussion last week on Christmas celebration. This is the second in the series on Christmas celebration. As I told you earlier, I'm from Christian College and I'm very proud of it. Yes, very proud of it. And I also believe if I'm what I am today, the credit goes to my teachers. The way how they trained and the number of chances they have given me, the guidance they extended to me. So I have some idea of Christ, teachings, mission and life. Usually during Christmas celebration, we find at residences of all Christian brethren and also in holy places, churches, we find star on the top of the church, a big star. Well, the feeling is that a star is seen at the time of birth of Jesus Christ, a special star at that time. And also some say that the star reached the earth. Different interpretations of the event. What does Baba say about this star appearing at the time of the birth of Jesus Christ? What does Baba say? Baba says, the star shines, but Jesus' brilliance, Jesus' radiance, Jesus' glory, Jesus' light of love is much more than the star there. The star there is just material, a physical body. But Jesus' life, his contribution to humanity, his love, they naturally excel any star for that matter. And Swami speaks of Jesus Christ as an ideal in the sense that he has no attachment to the self at all. He has no attachment. If we go through his life, we find him spending time at different places. 7 years at one place, 12 years at another place, in deep penance at one place, wandering in the woods at another time. He is not attached to any group, not attached to any place. No pain, no sorrow at any moment of time. Jesus symbolizes the non-dual experience, the experience of a blissful state. That's how Swami represents him. And Bhagavan always refers to Jesus Christ as the one who has got the heart that responds to the anguish, grief and suffering of the poor. He responds to every cry for peace and brotherhood. This is how Swami looks at Jesus Christ. Jesus stands for brotherhood. Jesus stands for love. Jesus means response to the poor and the needy people, suffering. Therefore, Christmas celebration wants every one of us to respond to the needs of the people, to attend to those people that need our support and help. Bhagavan said another point of Christ. Jesus spent all his lifetime preaching the principle of love. The principle of love. In the same context, Baba says, in the same lecture, that's what this avatar is also doing. Jesus preached love throughout his lifetime, and this is what this avatar is presently doing. That establishes a parallel between two avatars, between two saintly, noble, superhuman, transcendental divinity that worked till the last breath for the spread of love, friendship and brotherhood. We love Baba for another reason, that he brings to our notice certain things that we haven't been familiar, we haven't heard till then. As I brought your attention that I'm the product of the Christian College, certain things that Baba said I have not heard there, though I spent 3 decades there. What does he say? In Tibetan scripts, it is clearly written that Jesus is addressed as Isha is Jesus. And Swami tells this way, Isha, repeat that word, Isha. That is this side, he said it. Further he adds, Isha, Sai, Ishvara. All mean the same. Isha, Sai, Isha, Sarvesha, Sai, Ishvara are just the same. A beautiful thing which I have not heard before until Baba said. Further, he also adds, it is Jesus who addressed his Father in heaven. Abba. Abba means Father. Now Swami says, repeat that word, Abba. That's it. It is Baba. That's it. In other words, trying to tell us that Baba is the second coming of Christ, that Baba is the cosmic Christ, that the mission of Baba is same as the mission of Jesus Christ. That is very well clear. And further, Swami says this point. His interpretation is quite novel, my friends. It's not new to anybody else. Is not new to all of you, but yet it's absolutely necessary to remind ourselves time and again. His original interpretation, that we have not heard before, that original, unique style. Swami speaks of the Last Supper. The Last Supper, what does Jesus do? What he did was, he washed the feet of his disciples. He wiped their feet and dined with them. At the dining table, Jesus says, "The bread you are eating now is my flesh. The wine you are drinking now is my blood. Wine is my blood, and the bread is my flesh." That's what Baba says about Jesus Christ, saying these words to his disciples during the Last Supper. Last Supper. Just on the face value, how can bread be his flesh? How can blood be his wine? Having heard this, can disciples still partake it? Can they be dare enough to drink the wine of their guru? No. Swami gives this meaning. Anyone, any person, any individual with flesh and blood should be respected, should be loved, should be cared for with all your concern, as much as you care me. The love towards me, the respect you have towards me, your adoration, your worshipfulness towards me should be extended to every other individual with flesh and blood. All are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. All are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. Baba puts it this way, Sarvadeva namaskaram keshavam pratigacchati. Whosoever you salute, whosoever you do namaskara, whosoever you respect, amounts to respecting God, equal to worshipping God, same as adoration to God. That's what Jesus said. If we care to go deeper and deeper into the subject, we find many, many parallels. We find many, many similarities between the two incarnations. Beautiful thing Swami says again. Christmas, as we know, is the birth of Jesus Christ. What does Baba say that? We know that. Christmas is the birth of Jesus Christ. We know that. A celebration, a global celebration, a wonderful event that has taken place in this planet Earth. We are very grateful, we are really happy for the gift of life of Jesus Christ to humanity. But what does Baba say that? One more point. Christmas is not merely birth of Jesus Christ. It is birthday of every one of you. It is birthday of every one of you. Swami, how is it possible? How does Jesus' birthday can be equated with my birthday? How am I to consider that it's my birthday? Now Baba says, you celebrate the event because you are very lucky to have been born as a human being. You celebrate the birth of a human being. Had you been born as a bird or a beast or a tree, you would not have had experienced Jesus. You would not have had an occasion to listen to his message. You would not have had an occasion to participate in his mission. Since you are born as a human being, you have every chance of enjoying him. You have every chance of being with him. You are given a chance to imitate him. Imitation of Christ. So, Christmas is a celebration of birth of every one of us as a human being to recognize a divine personality. Then Swami takes us to heights of spirituality. Many of my Christian brethren, with whom I moved very intimately, also do not know this. Because these are the words from cosmic Christ, the second coming of Christ, Christ Himself, a first-hand information. All that has been talked about, all that has been spoken, all that is written and read is second-hand information. Baba talking to us, meaning Jesus talking to you. How nicely he puts it. Please watch. It is necessary that we listen to God. It is necessary that we hear His message, what He wants to convey, what He has to say, what is that He wants to teach us. We should be patient enough. We should be inquisitive. We should have a spirit of inquiry to listen to Him in rapt attention. That we are lost in ecstasy while listening to Him. The melody of His voice, the brilliant presentation, oration, let us listen. So, in the capacity of a listener, as the one who hears, I look at Jesus as the messenger of God. Jesus is the messenger of God. He conveys the message of God, Jehovah. Jehovah is the Lord. And the Jehovah, Lord's message, is conveyed to me by His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus, the only Son of God, conveys the message of Jehovah. As He conveys His message, He plays the role of messenger of God. Now Baba adds one thought here. Really, I think everyone would feel that shock of surprise, that shock of excitement, that shock of novelty, that shock of uniqueness in Baba's style of presentation, the Baba's method of interpretation. It's not enough if we say that Christ is the messenger of God. It's not enough. Swami wants every one of us to be a messenger of God. You should be a messenger of God. How can you be messenger of God? When you love Him. How can you be messenger? When you commit to His message. How can you be a messenger? When you dedicate your life. When is it possible? When you are devoted to Him. So when you are devoted, dedicated, and committed to God's gospel, naturally you are the messenger of God. That's the reason why Jesus sets an example to all of us. The first step of evolution, the first level of awareness, the first step in our consciousness towards realization. The consciousness should be awakened. The awakening of the consciousness, first step, is this: to be the messenger of God. By being devoted to Him, committed to Him, dedicated to Him. Then comes the next step. You develop such a love towards God that Jesus loved his Father so much. He loved his Father, he being the only begotten Son. He loved his Father that he didn't mind any other worldly pain or suffering or scandal or gossip or rumors spread against him. He is not at all bothered about the world, meaning his love towards God excelled. That made him not to bother about this. Continue to love even an enemy. Forgive those that harm him. Forget all their sins. That is an unconditional love. An unconditional love that Jesus had towards his Father in the second stage of evolution or awakening of consciousness. In the first level, he was disseminating, spreading, preaching the message of his Father in his capacity as the messenger of God. And that spreading, the message of love, has become so popular, so vast, so engaging, so captivating, that he loved God and none else. All the rest secondary. In other words, everything else appeared as if it is the reflection of God. Jesus loved everybody. Why? Because everyone is the reflection of God. Everyone is the image of God, the very image of God. And therefore, it was possible for him to love all and serve all. It is that stage of unconditional love, of seeing him in everyone, is the advanced stage to which he has ascended. That is the state of Son of God. The messenger of God has become now the Son of God. Being so intimate, with total identification, seeing his reflection in everyone, this should be the second state, the second stage in our spiritual path. It's not enough if we go on speaking. It's more important to love him more than anything else. It's more important to love him unconditionally. It's most essential to see him in everyone that we meet. Ishavashrimadikam sarvam itkincha jagat chan jagat chena chiktena bhunjidah ma gurudakkasya siddhana Vasudeva Sarvam. Everyone is a reflection of God. Ishvara Sarva Bhutana is present in all beings. This state, you'll find it in the life of Jesus, the second step in the awakening of consciousness, what we call Son of God. Every one of us has an equal claim. Yes, I'm the Son of God. You're the Son of God. Eko vasi sarva bhutantaratma. Mama ivamso jivaloke jivadeva sanatana. Mama ivamso, you are the spark of the divine. Yes, he accepts you. We are in him. He is within us. Therefore, this kind of closeness, this sort of intimacy, love intense, love infinite, are the features that naturally appear apparent in the second stage of awakening of consciousness, what we call Son of God. Messenger evolved into a state of being a son. Then comes the climax, the third state. What does he say? It is so like that. The love is so intense that nothing appears separate from him. No one appears separate from him. He finds unity in diversity. He finds the same one in everyone. He sees him in everyone. And he is not separate from him. That he is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. There's nothing in this world that is separate from him. The same divinity. So I'm not different from my God. God is not separate from me. I am God. Yes. That is the final state of bliss. The climax of awakening of the consciousness, when he declares, I and my Father in heaven are one. I and my Father in heaven are one, represent the third state of awareness. The same thing Swami puts it in another way. The first state, calling him as a messenger, is the state of duality, Advaita. The second state of experience, of being his son, is the Son of God, qualified, non-duality. And the third state, to find total identity with him, is the state of non-duality, Advaita. In other words, from Dvaita to Visishtadvaita, from Visishtadvaita to Advaita. Duality to qualified non-duality and to non-duality. The three levels of consciousness. Messenger of God, Son of God, I and my Father in heaven are one. See, what a kind of approach of synthesis in Bhagavan's divine discourse. It does not condemn any other school of philosophy. It does not elevate any separate school either. He finds that essential unity at every stage, making us understand that it's only one and same, ekoham bhavasyam. I'm only one in different forms. That's the point that he drives in time and again. Then Swami answers another question. Why should Jesus be in a human form? Why not? Why not in the form of an angel? In another form, why he should be an ordinary human being? Why? Now Swami tells the answer, which equally applies to him. Swami's messages indirectly convey that he is one and the same. Indirectly inform us that he is speaking about himself. There are many occasions when he says directly, I am so and so. There are many more occasions when he conveys indirectly who he is. This is what he says. Jesus has come down in a human form. Why? The answer is to talk to you, to speak to you, to give you the joy of his proximity, so that you will enjoy that nearness and dearness with the Lord. Is it not true with Swami? Had he been in a different form, we would not have approached him. We dare not approach him. With four hands, do you see him? better not, because he starts appearing even in sleep. So we don't want to see such a figure with four heads, 10 heads, 25 feet, we don't want it. Because we can't bear that. So he should be simple, he should be one among us, he should be available to us, he should be accessible to us. We can talk to him, and he will talk to us. So Jesus, the only begotten Son of Jesus, this of Lord Jesus Christ, is in a human form, so that we'll have access to him, so that he'll be able to talk to us, speak to us. But basic thing is different. Not merely establishing contact, not merely talking to you. There's a purpose behind it. To make all of us Godward, to make our lives spiritual, to elevate our the standard of our life. We have been leading the life of a human till now. Hereafter, let's try to tread along the divine path. We have been considering ourselves very simple after all. So little, so tiny, so negligible, a dust, a particle in the dust. That's what we have been considering till now. But Jesus tells you, you are the Son of God. You are not ordinary. Shrunvantu Vishve Amrutasya Putra. You are the Son of eternity. You are the Son of immortality. You are the spark of the divine. Why do you consider that you are a speck, that I am a dust? No, no, nonsense. Do not entertain that thought that I am tiny, I am negligible, what am I? These are all the words said out of ignorance. Something like a man with hundreds of thousands of money in the bank, and he is not in the know of the things, but he is begging on the street. He is a beggar on the street, but he has to his credit in the bank, hundreds of thousands of rupees. He doesn't know that, sir. Similarly, we may consider ourselves, I'm a speck here, after all, what am I? I'm little. This doesn't speak of humility, no. This speaks of ignorance. This speaks of ignorance. What more you want than being the Son of God? What more you want than being the spark of God? What more you expect than being part of God? What else is there other than being God? What else is there? There's nothing else. That's what how Bhagavan explains the incarnation. Jesus is a reformer. A reformer. Yes? What do you mean by reformer? He doesn't allow the practices, rituals, to be followed in a traditional style. The observance of rituals and practices should be continued in full awareness, full understanding. Not simply a ritual, no. Not art for art's sake. Heart for heart, not for art. Therefore, here we are to celebrate any festival, observe any ritual in full awareness. That's what Jesus did. In fact, he condemned churches being transformed to bazaars, streets, markets. At that time, people on payment will grant you a berth in heaven. If you pay some money, your sins are forgiven. If you pay more, birth is ready in heaven. If you are in a hurry, we'll send you now. It has become commercial. Share market. A bazaar. And not only that, some of them have become slaughterhouses, killing animals. At that time Jesus stepped into the life of Christian world, Christian fraternity. He said, nothing doing, stop it. A priest cannot forgive your sins on payment. No. You have to repent for your sins. You have to repent. Satsai Baba puts it, you should even go to punish yourself. Self-punishment. That's how Swami puts it. Self-punishment. I punish myself for the crime or the sin I committed. So, sins are forgiven not because of the bill payment, but sins are forgiven by total repentance. Accept before the cross. Accept, regret, repent. Thy sins are forgiven. Sin no more, says the Lord. Your sins are forgiven. Sin no more. So the only atonement for our sins is to admit and to repent, as Baba says. Therefore, Jesus the Reformer also said that Sabbath day is not simply a holiday. Sabbath day is a holy day. Because at that time, in the name of Sabbath day, people were indifferent to poor and needy. Jesus said, stop that. Help the poor, feed the poor, quench the thirst, attend to them, even in the Sabbath day. Because service to man is service to God. He is a reformer. He brought a spiritual revolution, which was not accepted at that moment. All priests turned against him. And that led to mass campaign against him. It ended up, most unfortunately, to the shame of humanity, in crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Christ was crucified on the cross, speaks of utter ignorance of man, total foolishness of man, and it is a shameful blot in the history of mankind. They have put man on the cross. Why? Because he fought against that tradition. He fought against the lifestyle of a priesthood. A priest collecting money. And churches being centers of fun and frolic. Why? Bhagavan, what does he say? Yajna is not a ritual. Is not a traditional. Is not of traditional value. It is not a routine affair. No. Every act is yajna. Every thought is an offering into that yajna. And that place of yajna is your mind, the fire. The fire, sacrificial fire, is your mind. And every thought is an offering. Every act is yajna. What a wonderful interpretation it is. What an application it has right even now in this computer age. Any man of space sciences, any man of computer sciences will have to accept such a logical, rational, scientific approach of Bhagavan Sri Sai Baba. That's really great of him. Many people ask me, why do you go to Baba? What is that attracted you? I tell them, his message. His message attracted me. Because that message is universal. That message is applicable to every individual world over, of different age groups, of different professions, of different nations and nationalities. The universality, the Catholicity, applicability in practical life are the main features that you find in Bhagavan's divine discourses. All these things are highlighted. Then what does Baba say that? Having explained the divine mission, having said what Christ stands for, having said the spiritual evolution, the spiritual journey from dualism to non-dualism, now he tells us what Christmas meant to every one of us. What is that we are supposed to do right now? What is the true Christmas celebration? One, during this time, as we celebrate Christmas, we should resolve to serve the poor and the needy. Decide, take a resolution that let me serve the poor and the needy. Second, let this Christmas help us to cultivate certain features like tolerance, forbearance, charity, magnanimity. Tolerance, forbearance, charity, magnanimity. Let us cultivate those noble qualities on this eve of Christmas. Because Lord stands for patience. Jesus stands for sacrifice. Jesus is the other name of love. Somebody said, Lord, why do you love us so much? Why do you shower your love on all of us? The answer is simple. I love you because my Father loves me. My God loves me, therefore I love you. This is an indirect message to all of us that we should love everyone. Love thy neighbor as thyself. That's what is conveyed in dictum, love all, serve all. Let us love everybody because Swami loves us. My love towards you is a reflection of Baba's love towards me. If I don't love you, it only means I have not tasted a drop of love of Bhagavan Sri Sai Baba. Therefore Swami says, on this day, cultivate qualities like tolerance. Be tolerant, everybody. But we are not. Why? We get annoyed if anyone differs with us. We get disturbed if anyone attacks us. Anyone disagree with us because we have no tolerance. And here is Jesus who is tolerant, the very personification of tolerance. Well, he could tolerate all that is said against him. He could tolerate all that is done against him. That is quality that we have got to cultivate. Then Bhagavan also says, Christmas celebration is not an occasion of festivity gaiety, pomp and show. The observance of Christmas meant adherence to his teachings. Follow his teachings. Follow me, says the Lord. Follow me, says the Lord Jesus. Follow the Master, says Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba. Follow the Master, follow the me does not mean running after his car. When Swami goes to Gokulam, let me run after his car, follow me. When he goes to Kodaikanal, let me go there, follow me. It's nonsense. It's not that. Follow his teachings, because my life is my message. Following his message is true following. Not following just hire a car, let the car follow. Your car followed, but you have not followed. The car that you hired, follow Swami. Because car is just lifeless, it follows. But you are not following. Therefore, Christmas celebration meant following his teachings in our day-to-day life, as Baba says. And also, in a sarcastic way, Swami says, on a Christmas day, what happens? During midnight, people begin to dance. Dance. Of course, dance hysterically. Dance intoxicated. Dance in forgetfulness. No. That dance is physical, cheap and sensual. But Baba wants us to dance. What kind of dance is this? Dance in bliss. You dance in bliss. Sivatandava. Lord Shiva danced. Krishna danced. Rasalila. Dance of Krishna, dance of Shiva is not the dance that you witness on a Christmas day. Yes, I saw quite a number of dances. Nice to look at it. But very difficult to imitate it. It's not the dance that Baba expects us to do on a Christmas Eve. What kind of dance? Let me dance in bliss. Let me dance in non-dual's bliss. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa danced in bliss. Because Paramahamsa is in a blissful state. He doesn't know that he is dancing. Paramahamsa doesn't know that he is dancing. Lord Chaitanya danced. He doesn't know that he is dancing. If you know that you are dancing, you are a dancer. Don't be a dancer, but be a dance. Not a dancer. We are already that, we don't have to make an attempt. So, be dance, but not a dancer. Meaning, dancer is lost in the process of dancing. Dance remains, the dancer is lost. I and my Father in heaven know one. That is Rasalila. That is Sivatandava. That is the dance celestial. So, dance is religion. Yes. Dance is religion. But unfortunately we think being stiff-necked is religion. No. You are stiff-necked because of neck pain, perhaps. You are stiff-necked because of spondylitis. No. Dance is religion. Where in a state of forgetfulness, in a transcendental state, dance happens. Dance happens. You don't dance. It just happens. It just happens. Therefore, Swami wants us to dance in bliss, not in the ordinary way that we see everywhere.
And Bhagavan still says, on this day of Christmas, let's make our hearts quite pure with holy thoughts, with feelings that are beneficial to our holy, to our community, with beneficial, profitable feelings towards your brethren. Pure thoughts. That's what Baba said. Pure heart is the temple of God. That's what Gita says. Ishvara Hurdeshe Arjuna Tishtati. God installs himself at the altar of a pure heart. So this Christmas should help us to have that pure heart with goodwill to all, ill will to none, with all the thoughts that are beneficial and profitable to the entire community. Further, Baba exhorts us that we should decide on this Christmas day that we shall not criticize anybody hereafter. Because we feel happy in criticizing others. We are very happy in blaming others. If at all I am to blame, let me blame myself. If I am to criticize anybody, let me criticize myself for not being up to the mark. Let me blame for not being up to the mark. Let me not blame others. Let me not criticize others. That's what Jesus said, judge ye not, lest thou shalt be judged. Judge ye not, lest thou shalt be judged. And Bhagavan says, see that, I can go on for a number of hours like this, because familiar with both the texts. And here Baba says this, seek out your own faults and others' mistakes. I mean, others' merits. Seek out your own faults and others' merits. Know how good others are. Find out your own mistakes. That's what Baba says. Do not criticize. Paramahamsa says, criticism is the worst of the sins that you can ever commit. And Bhagavan Baba says, still in a simpler way, when you point out you are wrong, you are wrong. Be aware that three fingers are directed towards you. You are wrong. I am wrong three times more than you. So this occasion should help us to stop blaming or criticizing anybody. And Swami also wants us to spend time in talking about God, working for him, not in gossip or rumors. Somebody says, is it true that? Is it true? What is happening there? No, what is happening here? The candle is getting exhausted. The candle is burning. The fire may get extinguished any moment. Life is like ice that is melting day by day. A moment gone by shall never come back. The oil is getting exhausted. The wick shall not light any longer. The life is getting shorter and shorter. Yes, why should I spend time in gossip and useless talk? Can't I hear something satsang, something divine, something religious, something spiritual, a noble talk, a spiritual discourse, satsang? Why not? If I'm not able to appreciate satsang, it only means something wrong with me. If I say, come on, eat this gulab jam, sweet. If you say, I don't like it, then I say, you are diabetic. Therefore, you don't relish it. So, spiritual topics, spiritual discourses should be of immense interest to every one of us. Because that is your story, that's my story. Bible is not a scripture of history. Bible is a scripture applicable to you and me at this moment, right now. Swami's discourses are necessary right now, here. That's how we have to take it, as Swami says. There are two phases here. The upholders of tradition, as Baba puts it, and the second, promoters of deeper meaning and understanding. Upholders of tradition, promoters of deeper understanding, two groups. The promoters, or rather upholders of tradition, they want tradition to be continued. As I told you earlier, some come to me and say, Mr. Anil Kumar, we are not able to chant Veda, what shall we do? We don't know Sanskrit, what shall we do? We find it difficult to chant Veda, what shall we do? My regular answer to them is, God knows English also. God knows English also. Don't bother to pray in Sanskrit. He knows other languages also. Don't struggle to learn Sanskrit, not necessary. Those that know, good, appreciate, compliment. But we don't have to be breathless, feel suffocated, guilty for that reason. Not necessary. I can talk to God. You can talk to God. Mother can talk to the child. Child can talk to the mother in her own style. Child doesn't need to talk only in Sanskrit to his mother. Foolish. Upholders of tradition are of that type. Pray between 4 o'clock and 5 o'clock. I see rest of the day. Play cards. Pray 4 to 5. Play rest of the time. Nothing doing. So, not merely upholders of tradition, but we should be promoters of understanding, awareness. That's what Baba says. Therefore, my friends, the silent night, the arrival of Jesus on earth, the babe of Bethlehem, bears the touch of light of wisdom, carries the touch of love for the entire humanity. The second volume written by Moffat, Avatar, in the last chapter, epilogue, he writes few sentences, beautiful sentences. Will Baba succeed in his attempt to spiritualize lifestyle? Will he succeed? That is the question that Moffat has put to himself. The letters are put in italics for your reference. There Moffat answers this way, why not? Why not? When babe of Bethlehem, a boy born in a manger, infant Jesus, could carry the touch of light, should bear the touch of wisdom for the entire humanity, why not? Babe of Puttaparthi, why not? Of Prashantamayam, why do you doubt it? That's how he writes it. Therefore, my friends, we are fortunate to have been alive at this moment. We are doubly fortunate to have been exposed to a message that takes us to the heights of understanding, awareness of unity of religions, without any contradiction, without any conflict, without any disagreement, without any difference. It is not one of antithesis, but it is one of synthesis. Therefore, I wish you all a Merry Christmas. Let's Jesus, the Lord, blesses all with the spirit of sacrifice, with the life of righteousness, with the life that is giving and forgiving, with the life that we would spend the remaining part of our life in service to the fellow human beings. May Jesus, the Lord, be with you forever and evermore. Sai Ram, thank you very much.
Om Asato Ma Sagamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrutyormaya Amrutam Gamayat Om Samastaloka Sukhino Bhavantu Samastaloka Sukhino Bhavantu Samastaloka Sukhino Bhavantu Om Shanti Shanti. Jai Bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji Ki.
Jai
Bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji Ki.
Jai
Bolo Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba Ji Ki.
Jai.
God bless you.